I want us to talk about the family of God this morning. It started out with how do we honor God, and then I had to build some other things in. But all winter, I wish it was summer. It will be summer for me next week. Keep that in prayer as six from our church traveled to Ghana. There's 52, 53, 54, something like that going. And so pray for that as we're doing some medical missions as well as other things that are happening there in Ghana. One of the more exciting things is I'm hoping to connect with the church in Tamale. They have started a church there at the police headquarters. And so it's kind of a cool thing. We did send them some money to help them get up and running here as a church. And so thankful for Mustafa's ministry and us reconnecting with him. But if we got to talk about family, family has structure, right? Right? Y'all think that's a good... I mean, there's structure in family. It's just not an ambiguous thing. There's structure that comes with family. And if I was to ask you, who's your family? And I just randomly found pictures and put them up there. If I asked you, who's your family? Who would you start saying, right? Who immediately comes to your mind? Maybe it's people you're sitting with. Maybe it's people who aren't here. But you immediately affiliate yourself with these people. Now, I understand there are some family members you try not to affiliate yourself with, right? Yeah, that's my relative. You know, as Girlingville's looking at each other. There's some. It's like, do we got to invite them? We'll tell them the invitation got lost. Anyway, it's difficult sometimes in family. But when you step back, you go, okay, we're family. I got family members I'm not the closest to, and family members I'm more close to, and family members that we get together when we're in town, and sometimes family members have a harder time getting together. But it's family. And in our culture, family has become a big thing, and that's not a bad thing. In the Jewish culture, family was a huge thing. Really, we're one of the only cultures that now don't take care of the parents like other cultures. You know, parents didn't need to have a retirement. They spent all their time raising their kids, and they just knew if anything happened, they moved in with their kids. And our culture is a little different, and it's cool. It's not a bad thing. But it's sad when you hear older people saying, I don't want to be a burden to you. And that should never be, right? Parents shouldn't be a burden, or they shouldn't even have to say, I don't want to be. No, it's not a burden, right? It shouldn't be. But our culture is a little different. You go to the African continent, their culture is the Asian culture. You know, it's just, no, this is just the way it flows. This is the way it is. And our culture's a little not as honoring in that way. Not saying you all don't, but it's the way it is. Jesus had an interesting perspective on family. It's a perspective that we've lost. It's a perspective that is no longer embraced like it should be. And that's the culture of the church family. If you want to read a challenging book, Francis Chan has a book out. I think it's called The Letter to the Churches. And Letter to the Churches or Letters to the Churches. I don't know exactly how it is. But anyway, it's a good book. It's a challenging book of the whole premise of how we do church. Most of us do church to get it over with. It's like, man, can I get in? Can I get out? Please don't talk to me while I'm here. I just want to be able to check the box, right? We want to get in. We want to get out. Some of y'all, if you're still younger, are probably forced to be here. Well, they said, I have to come. Right? Right? Y'all understand? Look at people looking down. Because, and this is more of a conversation this morning that I hope we'll continue tonight and through the months to come. And it's okay to, when your kids are young, to force them to go to church. Well, I don't want to feel like they have to. You don't say that on Monday morning when they go to school, right? Some of the things that just boggle my mind as a pastor that I hear. Well, studying scripture is too much like school. Why? Because it's a learning process, right? And so learning sometimes is difficult, right? Y'all understand that? Y'all with me? Look, here, let's read some scripture. Maybe we can change the conversation a little. And Jesus speaking says this in Matthew 12:46. He's with his disciples. And while he yet talked to the people, behold, his mother and his brother stood outside, desiring to speak with him. Then one said unto him, behold, your mother and your brother stand without, desiring to speak with you. Now, I want you to know, let me put a little context in, is his brothers had thought Jesus went off the deep end and needed to be reeled in a little bit. The Messiah thing had started to become a little too much, and I'm sure the brothers, who weren't believers yet, kind of thought, we got to stop this. This is making our family look bad, wouldn't you? If you had a brother running off acting like the Messiah, you would kind of go, yeah. And, you know, but they all became believers later, which is fascinating study. Verse 48 then says, but he answered and said unto him that told him, who is my mother and who are my brothers? Now, let me just insert here, Jesus did have earthly brothers and sisters. Mary and Joseph, she was the Virgin Mary, had Jesus, but then Joseph and Mary got married and they had other kids, just so you understand the process there. And so there was siblings within the home. Verse 49 then says, and he stretched forth his hand towards his disciples, and he says, behold, my mother and my brothers. Verse 50, for whosoever will do the will of my Father which is in heaven, the same is my brother and sister and mother. And here's what's happening. The family, the immediate family, is about to be destroyed. You say, no, I'm not saying destroyed, gone. But the Jews who are about to get saved are going to be kicked out of their homes. They're going to lose their jobs for the sake of the gospel. And Jesus is trying to teach us something about how church culture should be. That we collectively, and it's probably good that you can see each other now in the seating of the chairs. We collectively are supposed to be a family. A family that does the will of God. The family that seeks to honor God. And you need to understand that this worship time is not something man-made. I always hated the concept that religion is man-made and they lumped every church in it, because this wouldn't work if it wasn't God-designed. It's just the silliest thing in the world unless God wanted us to do it. Do y'all understand? I mean, really, who would have thunk this? We're not of a religion that I could condemn you to hell or release you from hell. Some days I would love that authority. I would be driving my Cadillac now, just so you know. I would use it for personal gain, and that's why God doesn't give us that authority. I'd be like, that's a nice car. Do you still want to go to heaven this week? You know what I'm saying? I just Just being honest with you. I mean, I would abuse that authority with every chance I got. But family, Jesus makes kind of a sweeping statement about honoring God and our Heavenly Father. He's saying those without my immediate family right now can't be part of my family, which is the body of Christ, because they're kind of coming against what God desired to do. Now, understand, Jesus still loved Mary. And I just quickly want you to see this. On the cross, when Jesus therefore saw his mother and the disciple standing by whom he loved, he said unto his mother, "Woman, behold your son." Then said to the disciples, "Behold your mother." And from that hour, the disciples took her to his own house, to his own home. And here's the thing. Jesus didn't say he didn't like Mary. Jesus wasn't saying he didn't like his brothers. And even on the cross, he wanted to take care of Mary, because that was a horrific time for Mary. Okay, can't imagine your son dying, which is unnatural in the process of life, and it's hard for anyone who has lost a child. But to watch your child be crucified would just be horrific, in the sense that it would devastate you. And Jesus, in his compassion for his mother, asked the disciples to take her and to take care of her. And so I'm not saying the immediate family is something that shouldn't be loved. I'm just saying we need to reconsider how this earthly church body should function. That the love within the family of God should be of supreme importance to all we do. That we come together and with a concern and a compassion and a love for one another, because we all now, through the shed blood of Christ, have a heavenly Father that we should honor. And it should make it something special. The structure of the family, and I know this is a conversation, I hope you're staying with it. Ephesians 6:1 says this, "Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right." Just so you know, children, this is, to me, would, if I wish I understood all of this when I was growing up, but I wasn't a Christian, you're in a really good place for finding God's will. God's will for you, especially in a godly home, is to listen to your mom and dad. Whew. Success. Say, "Well, I'm praying what God wants me to do." Well, he gave you two people. Some of y'all don't have two, I understand. Maybe you just have a mom or dad. Maybe God put other spiritual people in your life. But you need to ultimately understand the will of God for my life is to honor my mother and father. Now, honor doesn't mean respect. You earn respect. Honor means you put a weightiness on who they are for the position that they have. I give you a case in point. I can remember after I got saved, someone in 11th grade, paid for me to go to a Christian school. Thought, man, that's cool. I'll go to this Christian school. It'll be fun. And it wasn't all that much fun. But there was a whole lot more rules over there. But it was enjoyable. I enjoyed it. And I got done with that 11th grade, and the guy paying for my school had moved away. I remember telling my mom, "I guess I'm going back to Cody High," which was not as good of a school. She said, "No, you're not." And I want you to know, I'm new to Christianity, but I did understand I was supposed to honor my mother and my father. And so I looked at her and said, "Well, how am I paying for it?" "You're getting a job." It's like, well, doesn't seem right to me, but I guess I'm in, and got a job. So I had to start paying for school my senior year, let alone waiting to get to college. And had to buy a car in order to get to school. Bless God for $200 cars. And put my own gas in the car. I'm like, man, this honoring your mother and father isn't the best thing on the planet. But God blessed, and I paid most of my school bill. When I got to the other end, some of it wasn't covered, and someone paid it, which was an awesome blessing. But honor, it means you put weightiness to what they say. You honor your father and mother. Now, here's the thing. I want to transition, and we're going to look at some more verses, Lord willing. And here's the thing. We're the family of God. All of us in here should understand we need to honor our Heavenly Father. This is our purpose for coming together. What does our Heavenly Father have for us? And it's no longer your family, and it's no longer my family. It's we, our family. See, God didn't intend for church to be this drive-through business where you come and worship, but to be a local body where we become a family to the honor of our Heavenly Father. And so if we understand honoring our parents, and I always have to throw in verse number 4 when I talk about this, and so let me briefly insert that. Fathers, provoke not your children to wrath. See, some of y'all are ogre parents. You're going to do it, and I don't care what you're saying, I'm your dad. Well, that could be provoking. You should be able to sit down and explain yourself, just so you know. Some kids are rebellious because parents create them that way. You don't talk it through. You don't explain. You just say, by golly, I'm the dad. And listen, there are times for that. I would tell you, if your child's 2, don't have long discussions. But as they get older, I saw a show, I don't know what show, but they on the show they said, the lady said, I'm having a hard time, I've never raised teenagers. And I chuckled, I said, there's your problem. You should have raised them before they became teenagers. If you start when they're teenagers, you're going to have some trouble, buddy. Because they're adults who don't want to pay their bills yet. And so you got to get them where they need to be so they can be what they need to be when they're teenagers. They still need instruction and direction. Anyway, all that's probably free, wasn't part of the notes. But and so look here, Jesus, again in Luke 14:25 says this, and when there was great multitude with him, he turned and said unto them, if any man come after me, in this wonderful verse, after sharing honor, they need to hate his father and mother, wife, children, brother and sister. Yay, and some of y'all are like, brother and sister, I can hate them any day. And his own life also, he cannot be to my disciples. And whosoever does not bear his cross and come after me cannot be my disciple. And so there's this teaching Jesus is making. And you say, well, that word hate can't mean hate. And I just want you to know the word there means hate. Just so you know. And here's the thing. You say, well, how does that feel? Well, your view of God is so strong. Your following of the Heavenly Father is so magnificent in your life that your love for the family is diminished. Because God's coming first. And so the family unit now is absorbed within the church unit. That's hard. Because here's the biggest problem. I had a conversation years ago, a lady visiting, and so she wanted to share. She says, I'm having the hardest time teaching my kids right from wrong, and it's not at home, it's in the church. She goes, because I tell them, and it was these rated M videos, whatever, I don't know, I don't do videos, but mature, and it's rated mature by the secular world, saying children shouldn't play these, right? And I just want you to know, if the secular world says it's bad, the Christians should step back a little bit and go, maybe it's really bad, right? I'm just saying, and she says, here's my problem. I tell my teenager, young teenager, new teenager, 12, 13 years old teenager, that they can't, but everyone in the youth group is doing these videos. I said, see, I didn't have an answer. I said, well, here's the problem. We all should come somewhat on a lot of issues be on the same page, because we're trying to honor our Heavenly Father. And I'm telling you, if we all came in and understood that, and as a church body, how can I honor the Father? Well, then maybe God put some people in your life who has some better rules, because you didn't have the rules you should have had when you were growing up, pointing to self. And so now you need to go, huh? Why don't you let your kids play with that video? Well, maybe I shouldn't. Right? And some kids right now are in panic mode. But how do we do this? I love, third century theologian said this, he who does not have the church for his mother cannot have God for his father. I just thought that was interesting. See, the early church had such an importance for the body, the local New Testament church body, that coming together to worship and to be part of a body of Christ was so important. It superseded anything personal, because they wanted to honor the Father, church became important. And I'm just, listen, I know this is a hard concept, because church in our culture has no longer become important. The honoring the Father is somehow done absent of the body of Christ that He designed for us to be in. As a matter of fact, Christianity Today, Joseph Hillerman made this statement. Jesus did not primarily call individuals into private relationship with Him. He called us to join a movement. I love that. To become part of a new family. The notion that loyalty to God could somehow be separate from loyalty to God's family would have been foreign to Jesus and the early Christians. Rick Warren says this, you cannot fulfill the five purposes, worship, fellowship, discipleship, ministry, evangelism, on your own. Life is not a solo act. You were created for community. If we're going to honor God, one of the things we have to get a hold of is, how do we do church? What is the purpose of the community that God has created and designed? And I'm telling you this morning, you cannot honor the Father and ignore the family. It's not scriptural. Every theologian you would corner and ask them about the purpose of the church, it is not about coming together to worship. It is about the coming together in life. It's about coming together to strengthen one another. The church family is God's design, and it has structure. To me, the church, where God gives us all gifts to function in the body, is the coolest thing and the greatest thing most people are missing. You were not designed to function on your own. It's crazy. God said, I'm going to give you some gifts that the person next to you needs. And people go, I don't know why I'm struggling. You know why you're struggling? Because half of you is gone. I don't know how to raise my kids. God, put some people in there to help you raise your kids. I'm doing the best I can. I'm telling you, I didn't want to do the best I can. The coolest thing about being raised the way I was is knowing I needed help. That was the biggest part. I've asked people all the time on finances and all sorts of, look, dude, you seem to be doing it. Could we just talk a minute? Because I don't have a clue. I have a clue. See, here's the thing. Isn't it cool, though, that God said, you're a little light on knowledge. I'm going to put some people with some knowledge and some gifts and some talents. And we're going to get together and we're going to be able to have a body of Christ. That's the intent of church. I don't know how we get back there, because now we just want to have church services every time it's more convenient for someone, right? I will do it Thursday. Thursday good for you, Thursday good for me. All right, let's not honor God on a particular day. Let's not make it important. Let's just get together whenever we can. I don't follow the whole thing. See, Ephesians, again, says, honor your mother and father. Hebrews 12:9 says this, furthermore, we had fathers of our flesh which corrected us. We gave them reverence. Shall we not much more rather be subject unto the Father of spirits and live? See, the church family has God the Father as the head, and he should be honored. See, when we come together, we should come together to honor our Heavenly Father. And when we all acknowledge our Heavenly Father, we get to start worshiping together in a real way of sharing. I get to see people's life beyond Facebook posts. One of the things with Facebook is it could depress you real quick. But sometimes I want to go, that's not the whole story in that person's life. When we come together as a church, we need organization, but it should be more like a family organization. What do you think? What do you think? The greatest thing for me as a pastor is to realize I'm not called to do every gift in a church. Everything we've done around here is me finding people gifted to do it and saying, you go for it. I'm here to support, encourage, help, strengthen, do whatever. But you're gifted. I can prove it. Monday morning, Shelly didn't show up. I'm the last one they call. I'll bring my kettle, little dog things, and we'll get into preschool. You're in cage one. You're in cage two. That's the only way I could function, buddy. I could do it about 10 minutes. But when I talk about honoring God, really, hasn't our culture lost honoring others? Right? Listen, we've lost it. Let me just put it in terms of funerals. Man, people used to dress up to go to a funeral, right? Why? Show honor. Well, I'm here. They should just thank me that I showed up. Well, it wasn't about you dressing up or not dressing up. It was you, hey, I want to show honor for whoever. Right? Did they ever in Missouri, I know in Michigan, if there's a funeral, you pulled over? Now it's like, get out of my way. And they'll zip into the funeral line because they got things to do. Here, pull over. Let the funeral procession go by. Wasn't a big deal. But it was to show honor. for what is going on. We've lost that. We've lost honoring the flag. And just between me and you and no one else, I'm sure you won't ever share it, I don't like the American flag being changed at all. And if you've got a police American flag, great. But I think it should say red, white, and blue, not even a blue line through it. Because here's why. This is my only reason. I like it. My only reason I don't like it is someone's going to put a different color through there. And it's going to tick me off. And so I'm just like, look, can I share my heart, though? I hate our flag out here. There are too many rules. You say, what? Every time we don't do what we're supposed to, someone calls. Do you know? Yes, I don't, and I don't care. That's what I want to say, just being honest. It's just like, and it's always at half mast. I gave up on it. We honor too many things. It's like every morning, take it down to half mast. I think we just leave it there. But here's the thing. We should show honor to it. We should respect it. We used to teach the kids, you know, don't let it touch the ground. Why? It's just a flag. No, it's showing honor, right? Honor. We don't do that. And so when I talk about honoring God and honoring God's things and God's church, we don't get it. We don't understand how to honor parents. And so with all this, we really don't understand when I say we need to honor God, put weightiness to who He is and what He said over everything else. We don't get it. We think we can honor God with lip service and not with representation. But honoring God means we put the things of God above our own family. To honor means to place above one's own interests and pleasure. Well, I don't like going to that. Well, you should go anyway. Why? The body should gather. It should make every effort to. And then it's to do it with delight and joy. I'm really trying to get to the message. Oh, my whole sermon was really an introductory remark. Isaiah, if you would, go to Isaiah 20 or 58, 13. This is what they're being taught about honoring God. If you turn away your foot from the Sabbath, from doing your pleasure on my holy day, and call the Sabbath a delight. I just love that because he's saying you got to change your perspective to not I have to where it becomes a delight. The holy day of the Lord honorable, and shall honor him, not doing your own ways, nor finding your own pleasure, nor speaking your own words. He's saying, look, yes, about honoring God is sacrificing yourself. Then you shall delight yourself in the Lord, and I will cause you to ride on the high hills of the earth and feed you with the heritage of Jacob, your father. The mouth of the Lord has spoken. And I know what you'll say is God doesn't want us to honor a day. Before the law, he said, keep the Sabbath holy. And I know that's Saturday. I understand. But the apostles in the early church, when Jesus resurrected on Sunday, the first day of the week, moved worship from Saturday to Sunday. And it was a day to honor God. We've lost that completely. It's no longer the Lord's Day. You say, well, we should honor God every day. Yeah. I agree with you wholeheartedly. But I guarantee if you don't make Sunday a priority, Monday's not. It's not. And see, here's where the frustrating part comes in as a pastor. I'm supposed to lead a body, and half the time the legs don't show up. The arms don't want to work. The fingers are missing. And it's like, it's hard to lead a body when you don't have parts. We're all called to assemble to be something to honor the Lord. Here, let me conclude with this. Honor the Lord. Well, you got to make time to be in your Word. And I know the more you're in His Word and the more you're praying, the more you'll want to be here on Sunday. You say, well, is there any reason to miss? Very few. And that's just that's my belief throughout all Scripture. Joyce and I, we're on vacation. We go to church. And I can remember my brother, we're in Florida on vacation, and he goes, you know, you don't have to. I said, I know I don't have to, but I want to. It's not going to take long for me to get in the car, drive to this church, and have services and be encouraged and honor the Lord today, and then head on over to Disney World, where I'll be frustrated wanting to kill somebody. It's just in my DNA. Because I want to honor God, I need to put the things of God in priority. To make time to assemble the church, the body that He placed you in. Here's the thing, church. If you picked a church and God didn't place you in the church, maybe that's why you're struggling. I know this is where God wants me. You understand? And so this is where I'm supposed to participate. I tell you, I like, and I need to find ways not to be here as much, but I like being here. Here's the thing. I enjoyed picking up trash on the side of the road yesterday. Part of the body. It took us an hour. Some of y'all needed to walk, should have been here. Not saying who. Anyway, it just takes an hour. Say, well, is that part of the body? To me, it's cool. You get to visit with people who sometimes you don't get to visit with. It's the body. Say, well, I don't have time. And I understand that. I understand that fully. But somewhere we got to start saying, how do I make time for the body of Christ? School districts used to honor the things of God. And really, parents, if you could do one thing for me, go to the school board meetings and say, stop having activities on Sunday. They took Wednesday back. But surely we could all go, hey, look, I know you're saying you're going to do it at 2 after church, but when it's at 2, we struggle to go to church. Just say, we don't want it on Sunday. Listen, there's enough believers that can make that switch back. Well, I want to single out my family. Here's the thing. I was so tempted the last time to go to the school board meeting and just make a fuss personally, but they're going to say, well, you homeschooled your kids. You don't understand. I do understand that school used to respect the church, and the church respected the school. I'm just saying, why not try to get the day back? To live loving Him and loving others. To live loving Him and love. That's how we honor God. So I'll conclude with this. How's your family life? When you say that, when I say that, when you hear that, do you think of your church family at all? Or is it just how you survive as a little family? God has put some people together for the purpose of glorifying Him and us working together. My prayer in 2019 is that we find ways to become a family. A true Bible-believing Christian New Testament church. And that we seek to honor God in and through each other. Are we going to have differences? Yes. Are we going to disagree on some things? Yes. But there should be a love for each other that is so unique because we have the same Heavenly Father. And we all strive to honor Him. Stand with me if you would. Attitude of prayer if you would. Just bow your heads, close your eyes. Ask yourself this question: why did God place me in this body? He put you in here for a reason. Put you here for a reason. He didn't put you here just to come worship on Sunday morning, but to be interactive in each other's lives. There's people right now in the church that are distant from the family, and they're wondering why God wouldn't answer their prayer. And their prayer sits in the pew next to them that they're not going to sit in. Father, right now, pray through the power of your Holy Spirit that in 2019, Memorial Baptist Church will just grow as a family. One who reaches out to each other, cares for each other, but with the purpose to honor our Heavenly Father. Lord, I pray that you'll make that real in our lives. We're thankful for what you're doing, but make us, Father, to truly understand the New Testament and the body of Christ. We'll praise you for it in Jesus' precious name. Amen. As we sing, would you just pray? Maybe if you need to come to the altar and pray, that'd be awesome, and give it to the Lord this morning.
If you'd like to find out more information or keep up to date on what's happening at Memorial Baptist Church, you can go to www.mbcnewhaven.com. You can follow our bulletin, stay up to date on sermons. You can also find us on Facebook or on our ChurchLink app. All the information is on our website. Please swing on by, check it out, and thank you for joining us.